Okay, hey guys, it's Jeff Lafferty, ArtCast number, I don't know, let's take a guess again, this could be 330, I'm thinking I did 329 last week, but we'll see. How's everybody going out there? Painting a Conan piece here. Kind of a scene from Conan and the Tower of the Elephant when he goes up to the tower and is kind of contemplating whether he should try to climb it and steal, like, you know, the fabled jewel inside and all that stuff. It's kind of fun. I guess I should mention this, like, before I really get going. I have, like, a bunch of pieces on eBay right now. They'll put some, like, cut some into the video so you guys can see what I'm talking about. But I have a couple drawings. I got, like, a Black Widow drawing up. I've actually got some of my oil paintings up. I got this one called The Ogre at the End of the World. And I put that, the other giant painting I have, called The Offering up. And, I threw up a bunch of stuff this week because I'm, just trying to get some money together for, the end of the month bills. I'm a little bit short at this point, though I think I'm going to be able to pull it off, but, you know, I don't really sell a lot of the oil paintings that much. So, if you're, like, really into the oil paintings, you know, this could be a good chance to pick some up. So, anyway, that's the end of the commercial. I'm liking the new setup I have on my camera too. I'm shooting with it's a T1i that I picked up off of eBay for pretty cheap. I don't remember exactly what it was. I think it was about $150. I got that quite a few months ago, you know, and I kind of intended to do, like, you know, just like this kind of blogging type stuff, but I just wanted, like, a nicer camera that I could film with. Actually filming, yeah, it is. Because I had a DSLR, but it actually wouldn't film. It wouldn't, make, you know, movies. It was just a camera, and I always regretted not getting the one that, you know, could film with. And like, the T1i is, like, an older camera, but it sure does make... You know, it works great for these, like, art casts. Like, the picture looks awesome, and the power supply that I bought for stop motion, the one where you can just plug the camera in. Oh, hang on. Sorry, my wife needed me to do something real quick. She's moving, like, the fish tanks around, or one of them. Oh shoot, I lost my rag that I was... Okay, here we go. But anyway, she's moving some stuff around, so I had to stop for a second. I was talking about the camera, and I really like the setup that I got going with this camera, because it's, like, you know, films really nicely, and then it doesn't really work for blogging, like, you know, walking around outside and stuff, but because the lens is a little bit long. I guess if I had a wide angle lens, I could make it work, but or a wider one. But it works so nice for, like, just sitting here and painting and doing, like, these kinds of, like, art casts, you know. But what I was gonna say, though, is, like, what really makes it work well is that power source, you know, the dummy battery plug thing that I've talked about in other videos. But, you know, I plug that in, and then I don't have to worry about the batteries running out. And I just set a little timer on the computer, that'll, you know, I usually set it for like 15 minutes. And then that keeps, you know, that keeps it from the card running out and stopping on me. And yeah, it just works perfect. Yeah, so I don't usually paint and oil during the art cast. I really want to get a little bit of this piece filmed though. I just haven't really had the extra time to do any kind of like speed paint type things. I've been wanting to take one of these oils, like, you know, and do that, because those are always like fun to watch, I think, you know. I've got one called Conan Fighting the Wolves or something like that that I did a few years back, and that's like one of my higher viewed videos. You go back and find it. And that one I did a little different. It was like oil on canvas, and I used the technique where I just didn't have any kind of drawing, and just, you know, did the whole thing just straight into oil. I remember that's a little bit of a sketch. You can see it, you know, because it's like a speed paint from beginning to end, so you can kind of really watch, and you can go there and see, like, if I had a drawing or not. But, you know, it's hard to draw on canvas, so usually if I paint on canvas, I don't have much of a drawing. And, but, you know, it's like a shorter kind of, you know, beginning to end kind of video, and it's actually kind of fun to watch. And I think I got a copyright strike on the stupid thing, so, like, you know, even though I get a bunch of views, I don't make hardly any money, or I don't make any money off it. Not for being Conan, but they used some music on there, which I find kind of annoying, but whatever, I guess. You always grab your best ones, it seems like, you know. Or at least YouTube, but like me, it seems like they love to, as soon as one starts to take off, that's the one that ends up getting like age restricted or some kind of music strike against it. Well, that's fine, I guess. It's hard to make a lot of money on YouTube, it seems like. Even though sometimes I've had, you know, moments in the past which seem to work. But anyway, back to what I was talking about with that Conan pieces. This is, you know, it's a little bit different kind of technique, because I do draw out this one. Just kind of roughly do it with a color pencil usually. And then I might ink a little bit, or just go straight in with the just like a sepia kind of toned paint, and get it, you know, down on the board, and then I'll kind of like start laying in colors, and then I'll just go right into the oil paint on top of that. And that's kind of what, like, all this area is pretty much just like acrylic washes, and then I'm painting in the oil here, which is like over his back and stuff. It gives it like that depth. I mean, I think that's what I love about oils. I kind of like love oils and I hate them at the same time. Like, if I paint with them a lot, I get, you know, just kind of like, excuse me, stuffed up. And I think the paint thinner and stuff just really affects me. So I don't like to paint all the time with them. But then I love the depth you get out of oils. Which I know I get depth with, you know, my acrylics and color pencils and all that. But it's like a different kind of look, though. The oils, you know, it's I don't know how to describe it. It's like, especially when I paint, like when I paint like out of my head. You know what I mean? Like, that's when I feel like I can't quite, like, if I go from photos with the acrylics and the color pencil technique, it like works fine and I'm happy with it. But when I paint something that's kind of like a more of a fantasy type subject, or like something like this one where I just kind of like go for it and I don't really find photo reference or anything, then that's when I feel like I need the oil to make it work and look. For some reason it just doesn't come out the way I like the look of the pieces don't come out like how I like, you know, the other way. So I think that's why I keep coming back to it, because sometimes I just get so tired of it. I'm like, you know, just sick of oils and I don't want to paint with them no more. And I almost like, you know, feel like I'm going to like quit painting with oils like completely. But, you know, time goes by and I get them out again. But it's a nice, you know, kind of mix, I guess, because, you know, like when I paint, you know, like an underpainting with acrylics, and then I just paint over the top with oils, the oils go on pretty thin. So it's like I can just do it all in one pass. And, you know, and it works out, you know. Rather than when I just go straight oils and I'm like painting for days and days with this stuff. I mean, it is a long time to be, you know, in contact with, like, I mean, I don't use turpentine. I can't stand that stuff. So I know there's like some oil painters who are like, that's a big part of their medium, and, you know, they believe in it and that's the way it's got to be, but not on my paintings. I don't use turpentine ever. I cannot take the smell of that shit. So I pretty much just use, like, as far as like a medium for my oils, I'll use linseed oil and paint thinner, and not mix it or anything, just separately. I just have a cup of paint or of linseed oil sitting by my sitting by my palette, and then I have like a cup of paint thinner, which I kind of just clean my brushes with, and then the linseed oil is pretty much what I use to thin things with. And that's pretty much it. And that's one of those pieces that went up this week. I think it was the ogre at the end of the world piece. Somebody was talking about like a limited palette, and that is like true with my art. Is I like to paint with like a very limited palette. You know, I don't always use the same colors, but in general I'll just use like one red, one blue, one brown, and you know, one of each primary color, brown and I don't use black, like, you know, I've talked about like a million times. I don't use black in the oil, which I know that's like a, I had a friend who used to paint in oils and we used to argue about that all the time. But the thing is, I don't think there's a right or wrong answer, because he used black and the paintings came out awesome. And I didn't use black and my paintings came out just fine too, you know. So I don't think there was, you know, ever, or, you know, there is like a right or wrong answer there. I think it's just, you know, me and him like to argue anyway, so that was just sort of what we did. Especially about painting techniques and stuff, you know. But I mean, I use black, but, you know, I put it underneath, like I always talk about, so. And then I just paint with color, so. Because I don't like to put the black in the paint, because I think it makes it look gray. So I know if you've watched my videos, you've heard that like a million times. And then when I do paint things that look black, like, you know, just like this shadow down here by his elbow, I just kind of want a sharp something in there. What I'll use is a blue and red mixed together, so it's like actually a deep purple, but it looks black. But when you blend it out, you know, in the whatever you're doing, it doesn't come out. It doesn't turn things gray. I don't know. I mean, somebody told me that, like, when I was in art school, about, you know, paint being muddied down. And I've always just, like, you know, had this fear of it, even though I don't feel that my paintings have ever been muddied down, but it's just what, you know, I've always, like, been totally cautious of that constantly. And I don't know if any, you know, I mean, I never really studied painting with anybody, so I have no idea, like, if other people do it that way or not. I remember once, there was this guy, Bob Rett, who was a really awesome artist. I think I've talked about him a few times on here. And he was taking this painting course. I can't remember the guy's name, but he was like, you know, he painted in this, like, the old master's technique kind of thing, you know, very, like, with the, like, the Renaissance kind of painters. He loved Da Vinci. Thought he was, like, you know, like, he had figured it all out, and that's how you paint, you know. And, you know, so, but I didn't take the course with him, but I went and visited him. I dropped in one day while they were painting, and it was interesting to see the way they were doing it, because they basically were laying out a super tight drawing. I mean, everything was tight, tight, tight. There was no sort of quick, you know, I don't know what you call it, spontaneous anything with these guys. Everything was absolutely planned. And so anyway, this is actually where I got the painting on board anyway. Not the painting on MDF. That I picked up from Mark Ratz when he did his interview on my show. But they were painting on Masonite that was gessoed, and the guy, you know, I can't remember what his name is. Maybe I should look it up and try to find it online. But I don't know if I could even remember enough about him that I could find it. This was years ago. This was like, you know, 99 or something like that, or somewhere around that time. But they were painting on Masonite, and they would gesso it, and they would gesso it with the marble grounds add in. They wouldn't just buy the gesso at the art store, because that stuff wasn't good enough. They'd have to have the marble dust, and then they, you know, put like 3 coats on there, I think, and sand in between. So that sucker was like slick and felt like rock by the time they got done doing that. A little too slick of a surface probably for me. And I also just used the cheap gesso, so. Anyway, when they started painting, like, I went to this thing, because it was like, there was like an opening, I don't know what, like the first night of the course, they all kind of went to this hotel bar kind of thing and did this slideshow, talked about art, and I went with Bob to that thing, because I was like open. And then me and my buddy Sean Tiffany went to this, hang on. See, there went the timer, so it just works perfect, you know. The timer goes off, and then I stop talking, I pull the card out, and I just start right back up. So, okay, Yeah, it just works nicely. But anyway, so me and my buddy Sean, we trekked over to this course and went and visited Bob like one day while they were painting. I think it was like a 3-day course and cost, you know, quite a bit of money. A lot of these art courses cost a bunch, you know. But while we were there, I think Bob was just kind of in the middle of this tight drawing, but basically, like the technique or whatever you want to call it was to do a very, you know, incredibly tight drawing. And I'm not sure if they were like charcoal or what when they were in the drawing phase. But basically, you'd follow that up like very quickly with painting the piece in black and white, basically. So you would do this like complete tonal underpainting in black and white, and most everybody was doing like portraits and all that, or copies of like the masters. I think that's what Bob was doing. He was like doing a copy of someone, like of some old master's piece, and so that's another one that, you know, I don't know, like excessively doing that too much. I mean, I've definitely, you know, like in art, you know, come across people who just, I don't know, they do like the master studies like over and over and over again. And I agree with that. I think that especially in, when you're younger, like I've done it when I was a kid, but I think that that loses its like effectiveness pretty quickly, in my opinion. I don't know. I might be wrong there. And I've seen like Jeff Watson over on his channel doing those things quite a bit. And I really respect him as like an art teacher and stuff. And I think if I was to ever like take a class, that's probably where I would go. Though I don't really think I'll be taking too many classes at this point. I think it's too late for me. Whatever stuff I do wrong, it's just going to continue to be wrong. But anyway, I know they believe, you know, a lot in doing master studies and that kind of stuff. But, you know, whatever. It's a lot of it, I think, is just where you're at as an artist, you know? And I think if you're just trying to learn how to work a brush and shade and, you know, how to paint skin and things like that, if you're at that basic level, then it's like you should do some just to, like, learn that. But once you kind of master that, I feel like the master study isn't as effective anymore. And you should just kind of work on your own work, because there's just no point in, you know, excessively copying, you know, Rembrandt and all that. But that's just my take on it. I'm sure other people have theirs, but anyway, back to this technique, this old master's kind of technique that this guy was teaching. They'd paint out the painting in like black and white, basically. And then they would come back, and you know, I'm trying to think, because like I know they were working in oil. And they were doing this like in the space of like 3 days. So like it makes me question like what that first like painting was in, because how did they dry out those oils quick enough to paint over them again, you know? I don't know. But at any rate, that's what they were doing. And then the second part of it was they would glaze in color, and the black, so they'd have like a black and white piece basically, and then they would just kind of glaze in the skin tone, like a wash over each section. So like if it was skin tone, it would be like a brown or whatever, peachy color, and then, you know, the background's blue or whatever, they would glaze that in. But they would do it very thinly so that it would keep all the you know, detail and stuff from the underpainting that was like very detailed and, you know, finished. And then they would come in and paint. And this is where I wonder if, like, their technique was completely, like, you know, like the old masters. And, you know, that's the thing. It's like a broad term when you say old masters. There's, like, a lot of painters back then. And I don't know that they all had the exact same technique like this guy was saying. But they would, on the light areas, they would go in, and they were pretty much like repainting those areas. And but, you know, any kind of light area would be painted up, basically. And then all the darks would be just these thin glazes. And it looked really nice, and it looked very, you know, very awesome. And I know I picked stuff up because, like, you know, with my own technique, especially with the color pencil and stuff, that is kind of it, you know, very, you know, detailed drawing, spray over it with the airbrush, which, you know, could be, like, considered the glaze of color, and then, you know, you work on all the light areas, and the black areas or the dark areas would be just glazed. And that's kind of it. What was I going to say? The one other thing, though, that I found really interesting, this was almost why I brought it up in the very beginning, because I was talking about putting black in your paintings. But this dude, he had this system of mixing, and I know there's a name, there's like a real fancy name for this, that it's just slipping my mind at the moment. But where he would lay out, like, white, and then, let me grab a piece of paper. Move this for a second. I see, you guys see what I'm doing? But he would lay out white, like a color, like, so you'd have this long palette. Can you guys see that? And then he would, like, have, like, yellow. He had a bunch. He would paint with a lot of colors. So he would have, you know, a couple different yellows. Like that kind of thing. And then he would have a bunch of different reds. It'd be nice if I actually did this in color so you guys can understand what I'm talking about, right? And then he would have, like, a big old blob of black over here somewhere. Maybe I'd get rid of that one too. But he'd have like this big block of blacks. And it, I think he even had it gridded. I'm not sure. And then he would progressively mix. He would mix up. So he'd have yellow here, like some ochre. And then he'd have, like, you know, he'd squirt out, you know, 10 squirts of this ochre. And he would take a little bit of black here, he'd put a little bit more in here, a little bit more in here, a little bit more in there, a little bit more in there, a whole bunch more in there, and then, like, this one would be very dark. And he would do that for all the yellows. And then he would do that same thing with all the, say, the browns, until, so you'd have, like, a real rich brown up here, and you'd have, like, a super black brown down there. And then you'd do it with the blues, so you'd have, like, a very bright blue there. You know, super black blue down there. And I'm trying to think, what did he do that with the whites? I don't think he did that with the whites. It was just pretty much, I don't think he put any white in there, but he might have. So, I mean, basically you'd have like a little squish of like every freaking color under the sun. If you've ever like painted a paint by number painting, I think, I mean, it's kind of similar where you have like these shaded, very shaded colors. And then, you know, like the picture is divided up by numbers. You know what I mean? Like this, like say you're doing a dinosaur head. And then, you know, so like right here, you'd have like a number one, number two, number one, number three or something. And then you'd paint all this in three, paint all this in one. But anyway, it was interesting. I mean, to set your palette up like that, I mean, it was like an hour-long ordeal. Okay, so anyway, that was like the technique. And, I don't remember what I was talking about. But anyway, yeah, like, that was actually what I was talking about. Was like, you know, his technique was based on mixing, like, black into color. Which, yeah, I was, like, taught never to do that. But, it was definitely, fun. When I was younger, I was almost, like, a little bit of, like, a collector of techniques, I would say. It's like I was always on the lookout. I mean, I still am a little bit. But I was always on the lookout for the way someone was doing something better, I guess you could say. I think I actually am, because there's a guy that was just found online here recently. And I've been, like, really looking at his art a lot. Just, you know, nobody famous, but just a guy, you know, he's got a little bit of a busy look to his stuff. And, I've just been, like, really looking at his paintings going, like, wow, that's, you know, a very interesting, like, technique, you know. Bisley's technique, was another one, like, I think I've talked about this on here, too. I probably have talked about everything, so I don't know why I even bring that up. I mean, I've got like 300 shows about art, so could there possibly be a topic that I haven't talked about already? But like with Bisley's technique, I had a friend, this other guy, Eric, who really tried to take his technique apart and understand it. And since I was friends with him, I kind of just, you know, we talked a lot and we just pay attention to what he was doing all the time. What he thought Bisley was doing, and I kind of think it's true, is, you know, like a very, you know, rough drawing, draw over it with like Sharpie marker or something like that. So it'd basically be inked, and then he would spray it down very dark with like spray paint. And then paint it, just paint straight on with acrylics, and I think maybe oils on top, you know, mixing, along with maybe some color pencils at times. He kind of seemed to be like, no, it's all acrylics, which could be true, because I know there's people who are a lot better painters with acrylics than I am, but, you know, that was just, I don't know, just talking about, like, you know, collecting people's techniques and just trying to, like, learn them. And, he's got a very, like, tricky one, you know. He doesn't paint like most people, so it's hard to understand, like, how he gets that effect. I mean, Drew Struzan, that's kind of, like, how I ended up studying him as well, because he was hard to understand in the beginning, too. You know, when I first saw, like, his work, you know, I had that Indiana Jones painting, the poster for The Last Crusade, hanging in my room for a long time. And, you know, that thing's got some, you know, great texture and stuff, because it's kind of like the sun's over his shoulder or something, and it's, you know, like the circular technique that's, or brush marks, I guess you would say, coming towards, you know, the viewer. And they kind of cut right into the face. I always remember that. They kind of cut right into the eye and stuff, if you look at that painting. And it just was like, I don't understand how that works. You know? It's like back then, there's no digital anything where you could have made that work, you know, happen. And it just didn't make sense to me. And on top of that, they're so lush and rich, like the colors that he gets, that I didn't. You know, I was like, that has to be like oil, especially like back then. I just, you know, like lush and rich color had to be oil. I hadn't, you know, built up this, like understanding of a lot of mediums and stuff at the time. And so when I saw those kind of colors, I was like, no, that's got to be oil. But, later when I found his, like a magazine article about his technique, And, you know, it was like, you know, airbrush and colored pencils. Are you kidding me? I couldn't believe it. You know, I was like, no, that can't be right. That was a funny kind of story. I'm sure I told that one on here too, but I was like at a convention. And this was after I was doing comics. And that's when I met my friend Sean, actually. He was sitting there with me. He was actually on one side, and Bob Rhett was on the other side. That's how I met both of them. And we just got to be friends. And we were at the con. He was like talking about, you know, Drew Struzan. Like back then, you couldn't find anything about the guy. He was like super hard to. You just never saw an interview or anything, you know. And he was talking about this magazine he had. He's like, yeah, you know, I got this magazine, Airbrush Action. Which I guess that's, you know, that's not a magazine I would have bought because I never had bothered with an airbrush or did anything with airbrush back then. And anyway, he was like, yeah, you know, he tells us about his technique and those paintings are this airbrush and colored pencil. And I'm like, no, that can't be right. You know? But I was just like, I gotta see this magazine, you know. So after the con, a few weeks later, since we lived kind of close to each other, I called him up and was like, you know, let's go have lunch. And he showed me this magazine where he, you know, this article where he kind of lays out his technique, which is, you know, tight drawing. I mean, he's basically, you know, like what I was saying, the old master's kind of technique a little bit, but with an airbrush instead, you know. And read it, and then I was just like, you know, I gotta try it. And I couldn't believe that it would work, really. So I tried like a little experiment with, I didn't have an airbrush, so I just did kind of like a little piece with like either watercolor or like gouache, kind of wash over it. Drew on it, and I was like, yeah, this kind of works, man. And then I went and picked up an airbrush and went over to Sean's house. I'm like, show me how to work this airbrush thing. He gave me some basics, and it derailed my comics for the rest of my It did kind of, because like up until then I was completely black and white art, you know. I was really focused on comics and that. And then once I started painting, I was like, I think I want to be a painter, you know. And it just changed what I was doing drastically. But I think that, like, you know, that's how you learn. There's like, you know, I get called a Struzan ripoff, Rosetta ripoff, all this kind of stuff on this channel. And I think that's kind of something that a lot of people who love to throw that shit out just don't get. Is that that's actually how you learn. By sort of trying on different people's different techniques. And then it kind of builds up into your own technique at some point. That along with, you know, I think, you know, a lot of these guys who love to criticize have like nothing of their own. So I think, you know, they not only kind of don't understand that part, but they also don't understand like just the concept of like how to like learn how to paint themselves, you know. So they kind of fall back into criticism a little bit. Yeah, I don't know. That's probably a decent art cast. I want to keep it semi-short so I can actually get it out today, because if I don't do it today, it won't happen until Friday. And I didn't film yesterday. I don't know. I was working yesterday, but I didn't feel like this piece was like, you know, like at a point where it was worth doing an art cast about it, you know. So didn't film yesterday, but then, you know, today's Tuesday, so I gotta pull this footage, throw it into the editing program, you know, render it, and get it up, which takes a little while, you know, for like a 45 long minute video or something. Definitely doesn't happen that quick. But anyway, I hope everybody's well. I hope you guys, you know, sat down and got some work done. I've been trying to make them a little bit longer lately just to do that, because I remember, you know, people used to say they like to work, talk with me while I was painting, and I'm in the same boat, man. I listen to a lot of guys that do videos, and I like to freaking sit there and paint while they're talking, and when they're only kicking out like a 5-minute video, I'm like, dang, now I gotta go find another video. It's like, it's not, you know, one thing about like these kind of shows though is it's like they're not that bad to edit, since there's not a ton of editing. I mean, they actually are easier to make than the shows that like are like shorter, like a little 10-minute video that's like highly edited. Because then I gotta sit over at the computer and actually edit, you know what I mean? But like right now, I just, I'll just pop the footage into the machine, and then like I'll play it, and I'll just listen to the show. And whenever I need to like move something around, I'll just like slip over in the chair and do it real quick. But I'll pretty much be able to just sit here and keep painting while I edit the show. And then, you know, then I just push render, and then that just, you know, does its thing by itself, and hopefully by dinner tonight, a sucker will be rendered, and then I usually try to upload, and I don't know, by about 9 o'clock tonight, I'll have a new show out. So, anyway, that's about it. Take care, guys, and you want to support my work, help me make more videos, check out Patreon. Also, check out eBay this week, because, like, a lot of good stuff's going up. And more stuff, and this painting might end up hitting eBay like in a day or two also, so just trying to, you know, pay the bills and do my thing. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you guys next time.